And Father, good evening, and thanks for joining us.
Good evening.
Okay, so what are the chances that we will see that conclave as early as next week?
Well, as you've seen in the audience, there's a lot of cardinals who are already in Rome. And so the old law requires 15 days because the point is the cardinals in Rome can wait for the other cardinals around the world to come to Rome. But since this resignation is something that has already prepared the cardinals around the world, no one, I think, would say, I do not know that he is resigning. So everyone knows. So they have already made their move to go to Rome. Mm-hmm. So as mentioned also, by March 1, the College of Cardinals could already come together and may decide. They are given the faculty to decide when do they wish to start the conclave. Mm-hmm. So that is left now to the College of Cardinals to decide on it.
So that's a pre-conclave conference wherein they will decide when the actual conclave will
begin. Some call it the Congregation of Cardinals, which means it's inclusive of those who are cardinal electors, mm-hmm. and those who are above 80 and above who are not electors. So they would gather and they just have to decide when will the conclave be. Mm-mm. The essential requirement is the 115 electors are there. Mm-mm. But they could not wait for long. The law sets only for up to 20 days that they can wait. They have to start on the 20th day.
And beyond that, it's not
allowed. Against the law, because that is the purpose, to set the order for the church.
Now, obviously now that you've said it so clear, it appears that Pope Benedict XVI really made a well thought out decision. It wasn't only for himself, but administratively, he also took care of a lot of things by making that announcement of his resignation way ahead of time, and not really just surprising everyone.
Exactly. I like a reflection that In fact, in his resignation, he mentioned that him resigning is by reason of the strength that is required for the office, which is physical and mental. He has no longer that capacity. So he's making a decision for the good of the church and not for his self-interest. Mm-hmm. So here you're saying it again. He's saying it in public in an earlier time. It's also to anticipate the coming Holy Week, where there's a lot of preparations and activities of church in Rome. So way ahead is also seeing the effects of making such a public pronouncement earlier and making a preparation. And in time for the Easter, when everybody wants maybe to meet a new pope in that sense.
Mm-mm. So he really had this planned out.
No? Yeah, at age 85, then you can still have such a sense. Mm-mm. Well, the man is still still very capable, but he's coming on with this discernment. It's not easy. He mentioned that when he made the decision, it was a decision with severity and with newness, because the last pope that resigned was 600 years ago. Mm-mm. But he said it's still with, after his decision, there is a peace of mind. Mm-mm. So that's the context from where he's coming.
And I guess the flock is really just following his lead. We accepted it. And I guess we didn't have it really any other choice. And then the support is really just there for the process to begin and end for the new pope before Easter.
In the audience that happened this day, the Pope was saying in a very personal way, sometimes he doesn't speak in a personal way, he speaks like giving a homily about doctrinal matters, but this time he was very personal in giving his gratitude, in telling people that for the past days that when he mentioned about his resignation, he received letters all over the world and tokens, and it was very touching for him. You have that and they were writing to him not like a prince, but like someone who is a part of a family. So you see the Pope getting in touch with the flock, for he has realized that his office as a Petrine successor is an office of service, an office where you bring God to men and you bring men to God, if you put that into that direction.
More than anything else.
Exactly.
Right? More than anything else. Let's talk about the College of Cardinals and the composition. It really depends on the composition, on the kind of cardinal or the pope that they will select. In the conclave that happened when they elected Pope Benedict XVI, I'm sure you remember that time. Mm-hmm. Did the composition give you any sense that Pope Benedict XVI will be the next pope after Pope John Paul II?
In a way, yes, no, because that time the length of ministry of John Paul II was quite long and very pervasive, and it was very popular, and so we wanted. I had the feeling that then a certain transitional pope. Sorry for that word. No?
Okay,
but he was the dean of the College of Cardinals. I'm referring to Joseph Ratzinger.
Yes.
So as dean, if there's a sede vacante, when the seat is vacant, the seat of Peter is vacant, the College of Cardinals is the one that continues the administrative work of the Pope without making any innovation. No, he could not. They could not choose a new bishop, etc., etc. They just have to maintain. But in that College of Cardinals, Ratzinger was the head. And he was also the head of the Congregation for Doctrine and Faith, a very powerful curia of the Pope. So he has the name, the popularity, the connection, the holiness that is required. But deeply, he has a mental, intellectual acumen that is very deeply seated, which is good for the continuation of church. Mm-hmm. So when he was elected just for a few days, in fact, to manifest indeed that he was quite acceptable as a transitional pope after the long stay of John Paul II. Mm. But this time it's different, no?
The reason why I asked you that particular question is because I wanted to ask you this follow-up question. If at that time you had a sense already that it was going to be Joseph Ratzinger.
It could be Ratzinger, yeah.
In this particular composition and the way and the situation of the Catholic faith now, is there anyone in mind who you think could carry on the tradition but also give due respect to the transition that Pope Benedict XVI provided?
Actually, it's very challenging, though. This pope that will be coming will face a world that is more an age of secularism, very intercultural in mentality and in mindset. The issues about evangelization, the downside of the number of Catholics in Europe, and the rise, however, of the Catholics in Latin America and Africa, the deep poverty and the abuses in church, finance, and sex. It's challenging. A good administrator, holder of truth, holy life, these things, no? To each country, so to speak, Europe has certain papabile, a certain sense of name recall. There is more diversity this time. No one, two, or three would have such a collective sense. No, so you would suspect that it would take a little time for the cardinals to get to know each other and to work out on their profile. Definitely, they have worked reading some files about each one,
especially now,
their
right?
work, their mission, their and their character. No,
right.
And their sense of because as John Paul, as Benedict has mentioned. When you become pope, you lose your privacy. You are already owned by God and owned by the church. And that's how the severity of their task, of their mission. I would suspect, no, Time magazine has mentioned 10 names, no? The other, John Allen, a famous Vatican writer, journalist, an American, would single out our very own Cardinal Tagle, for example. Magister, an Italian journalist, was before labeling our very own Cardinal Tagle to be more liberal. And then later on, when he became cardinal, he was already in salute of Cardinal Tagle. Mm-hmm. But of course, you have a Latin American cardinals who would choose their own, given that they have the most number of Catholics now. Mm-hmm. Africa's cardinal once said, it should be an African, a black pope. But who is? Deep down, the sense is, the choice of the pope is really a working of the Holy Spirit. That is what the church teaches, no? Mm-hmm. The Spirit is the one guiding the cardinals. And the cardinals are only naming him, but it is Jesus Christ who has chosen him. We're not leaving that church teaching, no?
Right.
It's Christ who has chosen Peter to take care of the church. And for every successor of Peter, there is a hand of God.
Out of the 10 names that Time magazine published, what do you think are the common denominators?
One would be those who would be familiar with the workings of the Vatican, no? The congregation, the curia. The curia is the the feet, the hands, the mouth, the eyes of the Pope. So it executes what the Pope does. So a person, a cardinal who works at the Curia has a certain advantage, definitely, mm-hmm. in terms of network, of international exposure.
Right.
Yeah, that would be one. No? Mm-hmm. But there are also, you need also a good administrator for the Pope. They also mention an American cardinal, Dolan, and the Filipino-Asian Cardinal Tagle. They're all the 115 cardinals are all possible to be elected. So these names trimmed down by some magazines are media insinuations and politics that could be more outside as the church is also human and divine. Of course, there are also manok-manok within the church.
I was going to get into that. politics and the church. Do you think that at this particular point in the Catholic Church's history, that it will play a huge role in the selection of the next pope? A huge role.
Which means?
Politics. How huge of a role will it play?
Politics means influence, no? And I'm more on the divine side, rather. I'd rather say that, you know, when the cardinals write the name of the one they elect, they put that on the receptacle, they make an oath to God.
Right.
They say that Christ is my witness, and God, I do this before God, and I bring it into my conscience. And that site is the Sistine Chapel. On top of the ceiling, you have a site of Michelangelo's Last Judgment. And so every cardinal who elects is judged by God in conscience. So how would you speak of, to each cardinal, the core is, I do it for the good of the church, for what God wills it. And I would rather have submit that for the past 200-300 years, we really have chosen the best popes, to be honest. No? The one that would really have a certain standard about truth, of living, about teachings, about their holy life, I would suspect that we have the church has also cleansed its own ranks and its own way of selecting a pope.
Okay. Yeah. Final question, Father, before we let you go. Let's forget about the names. Forget that all these cardinals are in the running, really, to becoming the next pope. Let's talk about what should the next pope possess, or what kind of face should he have? Is it a face of diversity? Is it a face that should reflect the new challenges or the new face of the Catholic faithful? How do you see the next pope looking like?
One is a pope that is open to the interculturality of the world, different religion, mindset, faith. So any pope immerses himself into the reality of a very diverse culture. And so you could not speak only of one Roman, Latin, European culture. So that pope should be open to that, the interculturality. And to a pope of dialogue, no? A dialogue with faith, with religion, with other mindset, with faith seekers. These are essential. Third will be the truth about God. Any pope speaks about, from the chair of Peter, speaks about the God. So he may not come out to have a popular dictates or popular opinions, if it is how it's regarded, but he will still speak about the truth of God. So even if the world would not accept it, any pope should stand to what God wants by the nature of what God wills. And I think that pope will be what the role of church is, prophetic and with a deep sense of care and love. That's the personal side of it, no?
Should it be a young pope, a younger pope?
It's a greater advantage. When John Paul II was elected at a very young age, 58, if I'm not mistaken, he was able to move around the world to bring the face of the church to the young, to different countries who have not heard and seen and touched him. So a young could give the vigor and the energy that may so require. One maybe of the reasons why Benedict has stepped down, he has realized the deep task of just being welcoming conferences, meetings, audiences, traveling. You know, if you reach 85 and you travel, that's quite a Herculean task already. If you're young, a sense of adventurous, the excitement of meeting new people, and the joy of sharing the faith, because that is what essentially a pope is. He brings God to man and woman and women, and brings people to God. And that's a good role of a pope.
Well, Father Jerome Marquez, Canon Law Professor at Divine Word School of Theology in Tagaytay, thanks for coming all the way here to our studios to join us tonight. Maraming salamat po. And just a programming note, ANC will be covering